So, it's 3 o'clock. So welcome everyone joining us. I think we'll take a few more minutes to see if more people are joining. But hi, David, and hi, Tamuna. I think we will take at least one more minute just to see, because in the past people who we haven't used Zoom before have had some technical difficulties, so just to make sure we have everybody. Let's give them one more minute. Okay, I guess we can start for now, and people might be joining slowly. Hi everybody, and thanks for joining us. I'm Ido Levin, I'm the media officer in Bankwatch, and we're here today. In this briefing, we would like to discuss the role of development banks in enabling unchecked hydropower development. This is particularly timely since two of these banks, the Asian Development Bank and the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, are holding their annual meetings this week and next. Also, earlier this week, Anna Czechowicz Lesoska, the head of the environmental NGO Eko-svest, which is a Bankwatch member group in North Macedonia, was awarded the Goldman Prize. It's often called the Environmental Nobel Prize for her campaign against plans for two big hydropower plants in the Mavrovo National Park. And these projects were also supported by the EBRD and the World Bank, which eventually withdrew from them. So Anna will be sharing from her experience with this campaign. And then Igor Vejnovic, our hydropower coordinator in Bankwatch, will bring the bigger picture of what is basically a wave of hydropower projects that's swamping the Western Balkans. And many of them have the support of various international financial institutions. In a growing number of these of cases of such hydropower projects, there is a growing local opposition, as well as international outcry. Manana Kochladze, who is the executive director of Green Alternative, which is Bankwatch's member group in Georgia, who is herself a Goldman Prize laureate, will be discussing the ongoing campaign against the Nenskra hydropower project, which is the biggest of quite a few projects, hydropower projects in Georgia. So this is basically our lineup, you'll be able to present questions to each of them. You can do that by actually writing, probably that's the easiest, just writing in the chat here on the right-hand side of the screen, of the Zoom screen. If you're watching on our website, then there's a small box there that says ask them a question. You can write your question and hit send, or you can get in touch with me via Skype or Wire, where my username is Ido, that's IDO.BWN. I should also add, actually, on our website, the link, I'm gonna put the link here in the chat so you can have a look. There is additional information, links to, if you're interested in more background on each of the cases that will be discussed. And there's also the contact details of each of our speakers. So with that, I guess we can start. Anna, the floor is yours.
Hello. I think, yeah, you can hear me, right? I would like to present to you the case of the Mavrovo National Park and the involvement of the two banks, the World Bank and the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, in the overall process of how the influence was, towards the government, and also how the government was basically taking care of the entire development issues and development of the energy strategy in the country. So to start with, there was an overall strategy in the country to develop large hydropower, but also small hydropower plants. Around 400 of them were planned in the territory of Macedonia, which is a rather small territory, but quite abundant with water sources. So in 2011, the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development approved a loan for the Boškov Most project. This was a 70 megawatt dam that was planned inside of a national park of Mavrovo. This is an IUCN category 2, which means that primarily it is considered a habitat to be protected for the preservation of the wildlife and not for the infrastructure developments. However, there was a loophole at the time. Basically, the Mavrovo National Park was not reproclaimed, that there was not a new law in place. It didn't basically mean that hydropower development was allowed, but the government was following this rhetoric that if there is already an existing hydro system in the national park, this was happening before the 50s, and the system was developed in the 50s, the logic was that they could again be hydropower development in this protected area. And the approval of this project came in contrast with the policies of the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, who at that time had it very clearly put laid down in the environmental and social policy that they would not invest in projects which are located in critical habitats. It so happened that the Boškov Most project was actually a critical habitat of a critically endangered subspecies, which is the Balkan lynx. There are only 40 individuals left of this population, small population, and the Mavrovo National Park is considered as its primary and only reproductive area, which means we only see scientific proof of the lynx successfully breeding in the Mavrovo National Park. So there were many complaints and many processes happening from this point onward. The environmental impact assessment, the environmental and social impact assessment that was carried out for us was deficient in so many different ways. Primarily, it didn't really mention the critical habitat of the Balkan lynx. And so it was a subject to complaints on national level, but also to the project complaint mechanism of this bank. There was also local opposition by the local communities in the Mavrovo region. They actually organized the diaspora, and there were protests all across the world in front of the offices of the World Bank, who was at that time also considering another project in the Mavrovo National Park, which was in the absolute pristine areas of the park. As the whole processes with the complaints were unraveling, we soon received information from the independent experts that this the project, the Boškov Most project, was approved by the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development in contrast with its policy. So the report proved that this is a practice that shouldn't have happened if the bank was following the high standards that it subscribes to. And additionally to this, there was a complaint raised to the Berne Convention, which is the Convention for the Protection of the Wildlife and Habitats of European Value. The convention also came out with a report saying that if the hydropower projects are to continue, this would mean that the national park shouldn't even exist, and that the critical, the population of the Balkan lynx will probably would be faced with extinction. So as these reports were coming out, both of the banks, the World Bank very quickly withdrew from the Lukovo project, and the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development withdrew a year later after the loan agreement was expired. And it really shows that in even, the non-governmental sector was actually quite proactively showing and demonstrating to these institutions that their projects are in contrast also with national legislation, but also international law. And it was not until the international institutions themselves confirmed this that the banks actually believed it in a way and decided to take action and withdraw from this project. We have to mention especially the local opposition. These are projects that are not in line with the traditional way of life in the national park, and people living in the park are very much connected to the rivers and they mean life to them. So for the local population, it was not acceptable to have these projects in their settlements, basically. So all in all, this is in short how the situation has been developing over the course of 6 years. And just to clarify maybe for the audience that the Goldman Award was given this year in 2019. This is the 30th anniversary of the Goldman Award. It was awarded especially for the struggle that we had with stopping the two hydro projects and saving the National Park of Mavrovo and the population of the Balkan Lynx.
Right. Thank you. Thank you, Anna. We're moving on to Igor.
Hello, everyone. So I just wanted to give a bit of a larger context where this this whole this project and this campaign has happened. So this is happening in the Balkans, which is Southeast Europe. And when we were when we kind of encountered this this problem in the National Park of Mavrovo, we also started to notice this, that there is a larger sort of tsunami of projects which are happening in all the countries which are surrounding Macedonia. So Bankwatch did the research in 2015 and 2018, again, updating the data on who is actually financing this hydropower boom. And when we are saying hydropower boom, these are thousands of projects, more than 2,000 projects which are planned currently in the Southeast Europe. What we found is that a lot of these projects are actually financed by the public money, over 700 million euros in investments in last 10 years were these, they were like loans which are extended by the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development and European Investment Bank and World Bank Group, amounting to 82 projects across Southeast Europe, which were financed by the loans of the public financial institutions. And comparably, a large number of these projects is actually financing the protected areas. It's one third approximately of the projects. 37 out of 82 are in the protected areas. And this is important to say because just to kind of have a feeling of the impact of this large number of hydropower plants. From one hand, the fact that this space is a sort of a biodiversity hotspot. So if you're looking, for instance, just as a matter of number of species, like fish, freshwater species, which are there. There's 113 fish species which are endangered and which are in this area. And according to the expert opinion, there was a study done by Riverwatch and Euronature NGOs, which are our partners. 50 of these species would be endangered by this hydropower development, which is approximately 10% of overall fish species in Europe. So this is a sort of freshwater species hotspot. So for instance, also this is sort of just how it looks like from the big picture, but we also as Bankwatch, we went to some of these projects directly on the ground to check how they look like. And a lot of them are actually quite destructive already. And you can read a bit more. We can leave a link later to the Broken Rivers report, which we published end of 2017. I was actually going on some of these places together with Anna. I think I visited over 30 places altogether. They're all the same. There is usually drying up of the riverbeds when these hydropower plants are constructed. There are blocked fish passes. These are the sort of ladders where the fish should kind of migrate upstream besides the dam. these are blocked. So it's generally kind of bringing the picture of destruction. Large areas are deforested by building access roads, pipelines, and transmission lines. So this is just like, yeah, trying to kind of paint this picture, how this looks like in reality. And because these projects involve public money, be it in the form of loans by the public banks, which I mentioned, but they're also receiving a lot of subsidies from the states, which is basically financed from the pockets of the citizens. And since it's people money, it should be, you know, this kind of investments should be done to advance the public interest, which is not always the case. And it's understandable that public banks have their climate finance targets, so they want to finance renewable energy projects. That's fine, they should, but however, these targets shouldn't be realized by jeopardizing biodiversity. And what is actually also important, they should be done against the will of the local communities, which according to our opinion, they are the best stewards of their rivers. And this kind of chaotic approach where there's a lot of projects planned and not really enough of the safeguards for these projects not to destroy nature, it's starting to backfire. And we've seen it in the Balkans, for instance, in Serbia, just a few months ago, there was 5,000 people marching the streets of Belgrade in Serbia, capital of Serbia. They're asking for the total ban of building small hydropower plants. We've seen it now also in Georgia. I think that a lot of you maybe seen this recent outbreak of violence in Pankisi Valley, where there's also one 5-megawatt hydropower plants being built. And Manana will also tell a bit more what happens in Svaneti, which is the region where the Nenskra project is placed, which we want to explain a bit more about. And what is maybe my just last point is that it's not only the local resistance, but I think that this issue is becoming a bit more known in general public outside of the Balkans on Georgia. Together with Riverwatch, Euronature, and some other organizations which are part of the Blue Heart of Europe campaign, and then together with Patagonia, which is the sustainable company, which sportswear company, we collected 120,000 signatures, basically asking the public banks like European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, European Investment Bank, and World Bank to immediately stop funding these destructive projects and reevaluate their strategy, how they invest there. And so far, we have some good signals from them. There was just in March, there was we organized together with European Bank for Reconstruction and Development a summit together with them and some of the commercial banks, which are also investing in these kind of projects. And there was a bit of discussion how this whole development can be more sustainable, but it's still, I mean, this is still early to assess how this will go, and we hope that the whole approach will be reassessed, especially when it comes to also some other regions, not only Balkans, but Georgia. That's it for me for now.
Right. I think the Patagonia petition was the largest the EBRDs have ever received, is that correct?
It was the largest petition around energy projects.
Okay. Yeah. Right, okay, thank you for this. Let's move on to Georgia. Manana.
Thank you. Right now, I'm unfortunately not in Georgia. I am attending the Asian Development Bank meeting in Fiji, where one of the issues is the future of the Asian Development Bank energy strategy for 2030. And we are also speaking with the bank about the hydro's role in the climate change mitigation funding, because as Igor mentioned, it looks like lots of the development banks decided the hydro is absolutely green, and they are really pushing both for small and medium and large hydropower plants, and they maybe Georgia is the excellent example how this development is absolutely unregulated may bring more damage than even the benefits in form of the energy, not to speak about the destroyed environment and the people's livelihood. So if we speak about the Nenskra is the largest and the most advanced project funded by the international financial institutions in Georgia, which costs up to $1 billion and looks like that cost of the project would increase due to the lots of the problems within the project. First of all, the technical issues. But what is also important to notice that since 2015, when the project comes as the hope for Georgia's energy independence, and it was supposed to be already operation by 2019, the project still is not proceed due to the difficulties, as I said, in the technical terms, which includes that three times they changed the the design of the dam and all the different features, including where the tunnel from the Nakra River will be goes to the Nenskra River. So the last change happens in January 2019, and it looks like that it's not the final design. And one of the major issue here is that the project will definitely drastically impact the quite pristine area, environment, biodiversity, very pristine area, which contains virgin forests, and will impact also the glaciers, which is around the future reservoir. What gives us to say that, first of all, the area is recognized, has been recognized in 2010 as the part of the proposed Svaneti National Park, and it's the parts of this Svaneti National Park in Nenskra and Nakra area supposed to be also protected under the Bern Convention as emerald sites, and because this is habitat area for the species like bear, lynx, number of very important bat species. So, and what is more important, it's really represent the unique landscape and galleries of the alder, for example. There is very important beech forest, which you couldn't find anywhere in Georgia. So it's quite unique, and it really needs to be protected. Then the tunnel from the Nakra to Nenskra, it's planned in a way that it is very close to the glaciers, glacier. So when there is a big risk that which locals are actually concerned, when there will be the blasting operation for the drilling the tunnel, the glacier will starting to melting and starting to degrading even much more faster. And the last year, the people already experienced the impact of the climate change and glaciers melting directly into very And this, unfortunately, has not been started. So here, as in all, in everywhere in Georgia, because the Nenskra is not only project, as I say, it's up to 140 projects is planned. There is quite high opposition. The people are organizing the permanent strikes and permanently asking the government and international financial institutions to stop the work. So right now there is the two complaints, one requesting the compliance to the EBRD and European Investment Bank compliance, project compliance mechanisms, which comes from the Bankwatch Green Alternative and a number of the local communities. So, Ido, may I should go to the questions?
Sure. Or we go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah. Maybe let me just read it for those.
Yeah, please.
So a question to Manana, the government of Georgia, or actually Tamuna, do you wanna read it out?
Yeah. Okay.
So I will read it out. Yes. So question to Manana, the government of Georgia suggested alternative sites for the Emerald Network instead of those affected by the Nenskra project. The question is, are you satisfied with the suggestion? And are they legitimate?
Thanks, it's a very good question. Mm-hmm. While the government suggested the alternative sites, it's not still adopted as the plan, it's still proposed sites. So the Bern Convention has been holding it's not closing the complaint, and it's still standing, and the logic is that they are waiting when it became when this proposed site will become protected by the law. However, we also have number of the concerns with the proposed plans, because we find out that none on the river ecosystem is proposed as the alternative to be protected. And we are still communicated with this Bern Convention. So there, in this regard, the work is ongoing. And there was another question.
Yes, the second question was, why is hydro considered green? Why in Georgia not invest in alternative energy sources?
Well, this is a very good question, maybe for all of us, why is the hydro considered to be green? We have no answer, actually. Maybe it's because historically it has been considered the water is the renewable energy source, and you can use as much as water. Ecosystems of the river is not existing. I don't know, actually. The recent narrative why the hydro considered to be green is because it does not produce the emissions. However, in case of the large dams, it's even not true, because it's scientifically proven that in countries, and mainly in subtropical and tropical countries, the large dams are producing especially large amount of the methane, which is much more greenhouse gas, four times greenhouse gas than the CO2. In the first 4 or 5 decades of its operation, and this is really quite high contribution to the climate change. So they even consider that the one large hydro like Nenskra, you can consider it to the one gas power plant.
Maybe just a question, Manana. What was the Bern Convention Secretariat, what was their take on the government, the Georgian government's proposal, alternative proposal?
The case is not closed. So the case is still standby, and we don't know when it will be considered. So case is standby means that the Bern Convention is not satisfied yet what the government of Georgia proposed. When they will be satisfied, they will simply close the case.
All right, I think that's clear. And one more question, Manana, to you. In Georgia, dams are not efficient. Why do investors keep giving loans for them? What is their interest? In the case of Shohevi, for example, Indian Tata Power now owes EBRD. Why would EBRD and ADB keep investing in these projects?
Good question. In terms of, these are the questions we are usually asking the banks. If you look all the projects which has been supported by the international financial institutions in Georgia, starting with the Paravani, then the Dariali, Shuakhevi, which are like finished projects, you can see that there is quite a big problem with the project quality. There is the big problem with the production of the energy and electricity from these hydropower plants, and they even not managing to reach at least half of the project capacity. And in this situation, when the banks are so aggressively pushing for the new projects, means that there is something not correct, especially after the Shuakhevi, where, as you know, the Shuakhevi doesn't work. And for 3 years, almost once in a week, we have been asking the EBRD and the government of Georgia to show us the geological studies, which they say that has been perfect, because the studies we have been seeing has been shown that studies have not been done at all. So, and after this collapsing of the Shuakhevi in 2017, there is now May 2019, and there is no answers, neither from the government, neither from the banks, what happened in this place, except of the fact that geological studies have not been done properly, which we already say it them 3 years before when they start the construction. So, and only last week, the government of Georgia just announced that they may create the commission and look on the roots of the failure of the Shuakhevi hydropower plant after the Pankisi Valley crisis. So all these things are gives us low confidence that government knows what it does, and also very low confidence that international financial institutions are really care about the project they are doing. Just to be clear, usually when the projects are failed, the investors may have bear some financial risks, but not the international financial institutions, because they are they having quite high rating. And in case of Nenskra, for example, if the project will fail, according to the contract which has been signed between the government of Georgia and the Nenskra Hydro, the government should reimburse all the costs plus 18% of the VAT to the Nenskra Hydro. So it doesn't matter what will happen with the Nenskra Hydro. The citizens of Georgia will pay from their pocket, either for expensive electricity, either for badly built hydropower plant.
Right. Okay. Thank you very much for this. It is indeed very worrying. Maybe more questions, if anyone wants to raise any questions. In the meantime, however, I would like to just share that earlier this week, we also started a petition calling on the international financial institutions that either already supporting the Nenskra project or considering supporting it, we're calling on them to withdraw from the project, to learn from past lessons. I'm putting the link in the chat here to this petition. Yeah, and we're inviting everybody who joins this call to sign this petition. Right. Yes, the URL is bankwatch.org/stop-Nenskra. If you cannot see it, that's bankwatch.org/stop-Nenskra. Question to Anna. What are the next steps for the campaign in the Mavrovo National Park?
Thank you, Ido. So even though the two large dams have been stopped, the government is still going on with some of the plans to continue development of hydropower, of small hydropower plants in the territory of the national park. Several of the projects are in pipeline. Few of them are being planned, and there was just recently a call for tenders for issuing water concessions, and one of these locations was again in the territory of the National Park of Mavrovo. So our demands now are towards our government. They would need to basically stop all the construction work in Mavrovo, prevent the development of new hydropower plants, no matter small or large, in the National Park of Mavrovo. And one of the ways to do that is adopt a sound and appropriate law for the declaration of Mavrovo as a national park. It's a bit complicated. This is a national park as of the 50s. However, with the changes of the legislation on national level, as we are trying to accede to the EU and transpose European legislation, it also means that we have to change the laws for the proclaimed and designated protected areas. So this means that Mavrovo will have to have a new law in place. And this law we find to be of very high importance, because in this way we will be able to prescribe what is allowed and what is not allowed in each of the zones of the national park. In our view, if we have a good law in place, this will prevent all destructive activities in the park, and it would mean safeguarding the habitat of the critically endangered Balkan lynx, but also of all other habitats and species in the park.
All right. Yes, another question to Anna. Is Macedonia striving towards energy independence? This is the argument that the government of Georgia uses often to advocate for hydropower plants building.
So is this a question for me?
Yes.
Is Macedonia striving towards energy independence? So currently we have our energy mix is made up of coal and large hydro and very, very small portions of new renewables are in place. However, with this campaign that we actually led around the Mavrovo National Park, we also got engaged in the preparation of the strategy for energy development of the country. As of 2010, we have been actively promoting to the government that coal is something that we should be definitely abandoning in the short term, that we need to decarbonize all of our sectors, including transport and, of course, the energy, that we need to focus on energy efficiency, and we need to develop a lot more of the new renewable energy sources, mainly solar and wind. My country has a lot of solar days per year, and we should be using that potential to develop this this sector. We also did a lot of studies about how coal is impacting the health and how many jobs can be created in the new renewable sector, meaning solar and wind. So the government has finally, I think, reacted to all of this. And I guess this is because we also have changes happening in the government and in the structures. So now we have been working with the academia, and they have shown a significant progress in the development of the new strategy. We are looking at far greener scenarios in the new document. The document is not yet out, so I can't say the details about this, but we are definitely moving in a more, let's say, independent, but more green development of the country in the energy sector. And this is something that we think it's quite positive. It means also that economy can be also driven with the green scenarios. It's not anymore, you know, the whole story that we used to hear that coal is the driver of economy. Not anymore. The government is clear that coal needs to be abandoned. And in terms of the hydropower, I think they're quite cautious now in deciding where they would be building hydropower plants. This goes for the large dams. For the small dams, however, we see that this is challenging also for the government. I think the reason for this is that the small hydropower plants are still very much subsidized by the public money, and that investors are simply lured into this whole mechanism, and water concessions are being issued without very scrutinized analysis, like without the scrutiny needed from the Ministry of Environment. So there is still space for improvement. However, if you're asking just specifically whether we're striving towards the energy independence, I think all of the Balkan countries are trying to do that, more or less. In our case, we are just currently happy that the government is looking into more green alternatives and green scenarios forward.
Right. Thank you, Anna. Let's see. Any other questions? Right. Yes, a question for Igor. You mentioned a study. What period of time does this study cover? And did you notice any trends after the publication of this study?
Mm-hmm. Well, the study was covering the period from 2005 to 2018, or beginning of 2018. While I think what happened afterwards, or like maybe in the last year or so, is that we see that public banks are very cautious, or becoming very cautious with their investments. They're still not out of the sector. We see also, for instance, there's a clear impact of the Mavrovo case that in Macedonia that, for instance, EBRD will not finance, I think, any of those small plants which are in the national parks. Unfortunately, they are financing one small hydropower plant in what is the Emerald site, the proposed Emerald site, or like this is the future Natura 2000 zone there, and we are monitoring that project. We are not really happy how it unfolds. It's currently in construction, but in general they are more and more careful. We have examples in Bosnia that, for instance, there is one cascade made of 15 projects called Neretvica in Bosnia and Herzegovina, where they did a thorough study of the local biodiversity, and it seems that actually they will get out of the project based on the results of the biodiversity study. So it's sort of mixed, but I think that there is increased understanding that this is a very risky sector. And what I would like to see more is that this sort of conclusion is also made for not only for the Balkan countries, but also elsewhere, to see that this kind of development is inherently very risky, and that more of the resources should go to solar and wind to kind of have a bit more balanced energy mix also.
Right. Thank you for this. Okay. Last chance for last questions. Hmm. Okay. Otherwise, I guess maybe with this message, we will wrap up. And I will just say that the recording of this briefing will be available shortly on the same webpage on our website. So you can watch it there. Yes, and if you are watching and you'd like to get in touch, there is also the contacts of each of our speakers, of Anna, Manana, and Igor. You can get in touch directly with them, or you can reach out to me. Otherwise, yeah, I guess I'll just say thank you, everybody who joined. Thank you, Manana, Anna, and Igor. Yeah, I guess that would be it for today.